new site, and June Lee, founding partner at Wiseman Capital. Please give them a round of applause.
Hi everyone, my name is Jun Lee. I'm the general partner of Wiseman Capital. We started this fund in late 2015. It's an early stage investment fund based in Silicon Valley and invested in the US startups. We mainly focused in the artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, and life science. So we actually believe the technology these days are actually cross industry, cross field. For example, the AI and the IoT, many of the innovations is actually applied to other fields such as in the healthcare. So today, I actually invite one of our portfolio company, NewSight, the CEO of NewSight, Jonathan, to come here to share his experience with you. So first, how about Jonathan, you tell us how you started this journey and tell us a little bit about your background.
Well, to be honest with you, 2 years ago I was a postdoc at Stanford, so I was thrown into the deep end here. And I was doing a postdoc with Marius Berning and Tom Sudoff, he's a Nobel laureate, and they really have developed these very good in vitro disease models to study neurological disorders. What was unique about it was how they were able to get iPS-derived cells, turn them into high-quality neurons. And these cells matured very rapidly, and then you could start doing really higher-order electrophysiological readouts off of them. Which, this type of phenotypes that we were seeing there went way beyond the traditional just looking at morphology and stuff like that. So now we're really looking at what neurons do in the brain. In a brain, a neuron just doesn't stand by itself. It actually communicates, it talks to each other, it turns on, turns off, and creates these connections, and we can model that in a dish. So by merging different types of technology together, we were able to start identifying the underlying biology of several disorders at Stanford. The reality was, when I was there, I came a little disillusioned because they were really focusing on basic science. You know, how do you turn one cell into another? What I was seeing it was, this is a tool and we have to exploit this. We can really use this to start to create translatable neuroscience. And I say that because pharma right now, there's huge problems, particularly in neuro. Last week we were at JP Morgan, and we find out Pfizer is shutting down their entire neuroscience division. GSK shut down their Asian market as well. And now I turned this company and started it up. So we saw opportunities here.
So basically, while you're doing the study of the iPS cell, you found some model you can build, and you're looking into commercialize, and you see some problems happening in the CNS drug discovery, right? Can you be a little bit more specific, explicit about it? What makes the CNS drug discovery so difficult?
I would say, I've heard this from multiple people, and I've changed the phrase a little bit. As scientists, we're very good at making rats and mice sick and then curing them. But we can't do that with humans. We have prodded and, you know, chopped the animals up and all kinds of stuff. We understand how to do this in mice. But in humans, we can't do that. So we have to find a different model. And what we're doing is developing a fully defined human system that serves as a proxy to start studying neuro. It's a very reductionist manner that you can start looking at the basic intrinsic properties of neurons and how they communicate to one another. And this is basically the disruption that is present in most neurological disorders. It's especially mood disorders, epilepsy, schizophrenia, autism, and a lot of neurodegenerative disorders end up by disrupting these connections. And that's what we are looking at in a DISH now. So we started out as a smaller company trying to sell cells and doing some services, and have now developed internal programs for drug discovery, which we're partnering with Big Pharma to take forward.
So you're saying the difficulty of this CNS drug discovery is difficult because traditionally we use mice actually for the testing, and our human brain is very different from mice brain, right? And how big the problem is, and how you earlier you said that many drugs actually failed. How serious the problem is?
Well, it's for neuro, it's ridiculously bad. Attrition rates for neuro for first types of drugs is 90% to 95%. And the problem with neuro is really that they don't fail during phase one, they don't fail during phase two, they fail during phase three, mostly due to lack of efficacy. And by this time, pharma has spent, you know, sometimes $1 billion, $2 billion on this, and it turns into a flop. So if you can actually stop drugs from going into a clinical trial and test the efficacy in a neural model beforehand, it's going to save a lot of money. So that's where we come in.
Can you tell us more about the model and how you solve this problem?
So we take multiple tools into our portfolio. So the original technology that came from Stanford on how to make these high quality neurons was based on reprogramming technology. We don't use conventional differentiation protocols. We end up treating it as code. We put in a series of commands that are dictated by transcription factors, the same manner that you make iPS cells, and those direct the cells directly to a particular subtype of neuron. And we make these pure populations that we can freeze down and bank and then thaw out and mix and match at will in a DISH. So we can let the cells afterwards thaw out, mature on a DISH, form their connections, and start interpreting how these cells behave under particular insults with compounds, chemicals, drugs, and also look at different genetic backgrounds. So disorders, autism, mood disorders, things like that, that have strong genetic correlates to it, we can model that in a DISH and start seeing phenotypes that can be used for drug screening throughout the pathway.
So you're saying you actually can program, and therefore you can test the many kind of CNS-related problem, disease, right?
Yeah. The reprogramming basically accelerates the maturation. Conventional differentiation to get human neurons takes maybe 90, 100 plus days to get there, because you have to go through the regular biology. You go through a stem cell population, a progenitor population, then you have to let the cells mature. And when you do that, you don't end up with pure populations of different neurons. So the variation from one experiment to another is huge. Now, by treating this as fully as a tool, you can end up with pure populations that within 3 weeks are fully functional, have firing spontaneous action potentials, synaptically competent, and you can use this platform now to start looking how the cells respond to particular drugs. For example, a very simple thing is we can induce a seizure in a DISH and record that seizure. So we can, one of the basic assays for neurotox is looking at seizure predictivity. But in addition to that, now we can go in with traditional anti-epileptic drugs, such as lamotrigine and phenytoin and all, and block that seizure. And because these assays are not endpoint assays, you can start monitoring over long periods of time in a chronic sense, how do the cells respond to the, you know, blocking the seizure, and how do they recuperate? So there's a lot of tools that we put into our arsenal to understand the biology behind whatever we're studying.
So by doing this, you actually create a really big database for
Yeah. So one of the things that we do is we use multi-electrode arrays to monitor neural activity or the network firing of the neurons on a dish. This is a technology that exists. There's several vendors out there that sell the plates, but what's unique about it is that we start accumulating terabytes of data, and it's all how these cells fire and behave under specific treatments. So think about an EEG that you're doing to monitor neural activity. This is the same idea, but we're looking at changes in field potentials that are associated to the neural firing. And we can now start mining that for not only identifying new modes or targets to be druggable, but also prediction of modes of action of particular drugs. And also, I would say that you can use this for identifying how you would identify new drugs for particular disorders with a particular genetic aspect to it.
That sounds very promising. And so going forward, where do you see the CNS drug discovery going? Do you think the AI particular will be playing a part in here?
Well, I would say definitely. Someone's going to come up later, and the next speaker is going to talk about epilepsy as well, and they're doing a wearable device. So the idea of you being able to take patient data from EEGs and now monitor that in a dish, now you can start mixing and matching things like precision medicine, but you have to interpret that data. And there's so much data there that you need to do AI machine learning. We've already started with a smaller data set that we have accumulated, and we can actually cluster compounds by their mode of action and start predicting if it's going to be seizure-genic or not. So for traditional talks, it's very powerful, but we're taking this to the next level and start trying to identify use this for particular disorders. And then that can potentially predict how we should be treating these individual patients.
Great. So our time is almost up. And just last question. Well, new site is growing. Do you have any plan to expand it internationally, for example, China?
Yes. So right now, we started out 2 years ago, got out of Stanford, set up our protocols, and that was all seed funding. We just recently closed our Series A funding, and all doors are open. We're exploring anywhere. We're looking with partnerships with Big Pharma and jumping over the pond in both directions. So we're open to anything if anyone's interested in talking.
Thank you, Jonathan. I'm really excited to see the research and the innovation coming out of them from Stanford is actually getting to commercialize. And at Weissmont, we really support this kind of innovation. I'm happy to be here today, and I look forward to partner with people here. Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan and June.